You know, when we think of the love of God, we don't usually think of it being fierce. You know, we think of love as something soft and gentle. You know, almost with no ill intent by this statement, I'm almost feminine. But I want you to know that the love of God is fierce. He's a passionate God, and He's passionate for you. He's a God that pursues. He's a God that is not emotionless or stoic, but He has deep feelings towards His people. The Bible says that God is a jealous God. A better way of saying that is God is zealous. His love is fierce, like a hurricane. You know, in a hurricane, the safest place to be is right in the middle. Right in the eye, because it's peaceful and calm. And that's how it is with the love of God. Is when we're in the center of the love of God, there's peace. There can be a storm swirling all around you, but when we're in the center of the love of God, we can still have peace. Father, I pray this morning as we gather together, first of all, to honor who You are and to recognize Your love for us and to thank You and be grateful for who You are and all the good things You have for us. Lord, we also gather this morning because, Lord, there's a hurricane of called life that goes on outside of this building for all of us, Monday through Saturday. And Lord, we desperately need to hear from You, our Heavenly Father, and give us wisdom and direction. Father, some of us probably need encouragement. Some of us need a pat on the back. Some of us might need a spanking, Lord, some correction. But regardless of what it is, Lord, we know that You're motivated by Your love. And we invite You to speak with us, Lord, this morning and to us. And Lord, I invite You to mess with us a little bit. Mess with us, Lord. Mess with our heads. Mess with our hearts so our lives won't be the same as they came, in Jesus' name. You may take your seats in God's presence. And first thing I want to say is hearing about this debate over the color of the insert, that they forgot that their senior pastor is a former printer. All they had to do is come ask me. And so whoever voted for Goldenrod, that is right, because I printed millions of goldenrod sheets of paper in my career. So it's goldenrod. So whoever voted for goldenrod, you are the winners. You can collect your prize at Connection Corner. It's my privilege to announce that we have Kevin Burdett with us. Kevin is running for District 3, the County Council. So Kevin, why don't you stand and just wave to Eagle's Nest. Everybody give Kevin a warm Eagle's Nest applause and welcome. If you are in District 3, you need to make sure that you see Kevin. He's going to be by the door out here in the lobby on the way out. Make sure you stop by, say hello, and ask him questions. You know, we often think of the big elections as having a lot of influence, and they do have a lot of influence, but I can tell you what the county council does every year has more direct impact on your life than what Washington does. You know, so it's very important that we as followers of Christ get involved. We have the opportunity to vote for our national as well as our local leaders. And so I encourage you to get to know who's running in your district and make sure you vote. There's a primary this Tuesday, so make sure that if you're registered, if you're not registered, you need to get registered, but make sure you vote. Even with the next election, I'm getting ready to share a few thoughts about that this morning. But I want you to note, I don't want you to take the things that I say incorrectly. You need to vote. Voting for President of the United States is not going to solve all the problems in America, but we still need to vote. But I do want you to hear some things that I have to share this morning. So make sure you should stop by and see Kevin on your way out. Now, I don't know who got this, but I've been given a nice little turvis here, and I'm almost afraid. Is this a turvis? What do they call this thing? A thermos? They tell me they're like $80, so I don't know who paid out the $80, but thank you. 35? Do I hear 40? Do I hear 40? 45, 45, 50, 50. Now, if we just had like a blue cowboy logo. We don't want to mutilate it, huh? It would devalue. Hey, we got a good second string quarterback. His name is Tony Romo. So It's going to be a good year. I haven't even followed them. I'm so frustrated with the Cowboys. We'll see. If they get to the Super Bowl and win it, I might believe. You know, I was reading a book a while back, and the author started out by asking this question. If you had six words to define your life, what would those six words be? And I got thinking about that, and I thought, you know, that's a pretty daunting task, to do your biography in six words. The writer got this idea from Ernest Hemingway. He was asked this question years ago and actually turned into, it's a kind of like a legend. And Ernest Hemingway resulted in the classic story called For Sale Baby Shoes Never Worn. Now, I want you to think about it. You'd have to know his story. But I ask you this morning, if you had to summarize your story, give your biography in six words, what would it be? In fact, we went on Facebook and we got some people to respond to that question, and so I was going to share a few of those with you. It's kind of interesting. One said, busy, family, kids, love, work, and fun. Another said, family, friends, work, happy, blessed, behind. Another one said, unpredictable, real, providence guided, busy, protected, family. That's actually seven. Blessed, protected, they did use a hyphen to kind of bend the rules a little bit. Blessed, protected, struggle, evolving, growth, and love. And here's my favorite. Daughter, sister, wife, mother, friend, loved. That's a great one there. I really like that one. Now, if we apply this to the Bible characters, I wonder what they would say. Take like Abraham, for instance. I think if Abraham was to summarize his life, he's the founder of the faith of our faith. He's big gun in the Bible. Abraham's would be left Ur, had baby, still laughing. Because his son Isaac means laughing. I love Jonah's. Jonah's would be no, storm, overboard, whale, regurgitated, yes. And then there's Moses. Burning bush, stone tablets, Charlton Heston. Noah, hated the rain, loved the rainbow. And then finally, Esther, eye candy, Mordecai handy, Israel dandy. And mine would be weird family, created family, church family. But I started with a weird family. I still have a weird family. They're still weird. You haven't met Uncle Junior, you don't know what weird is yet. But you know, when you summarize your life, when you really think about it, you remember in high school when they had the yearbook and they had to summarize all the things that you did, and you know, it'd say your name and it'd say, you know, yearbook committee, football, basketball, and you know, you kind of summarize all that you've done in school. Well, think about summarizing your life in six words. I had some others that I made, but I thought that was a little bit more funny. But I made another one: healed, study, married, college, adopted, and ministry. And those are the big things in my life. What are the big things in your life? And did your life unfold the way you planned it or thought it would? I remember being a young man preparing for ministry, and I had all these dreams of becoming a pastor, and I had, you know, you have this kind of like game plan. You're kind of thinking how it's going to unfold. But I can tell you that even though I'm a pastor and where I thought my life was going as it's where I've gone, I can tell you I haven't quite gotten there the way that I thought that I would. Your life doesn't necessarily unfold as expected. In fact, if the Bible characters were really here today and they were to really summarize their lives, I think they would say it in six words like this: not quite what I was planning. Think about Abraham. Abraham is told by God that he's going to be the father of a multitude, that he's going to bless the world, that he's going to be a great man of stature, and he's going to be blessed. And yet, after God promises him that, for 25 years, his wife and him are barren. Do you think he really expected 25 years of infertility? I don't. I think it took him by surprise. I think he had to struggle with life just like you and I have to struggle, that even though we have a word from God and we have a North Star and we have a direction, we don't always know how we're going to get there. And there are probably many days in his life, like there are in ours, that he's not sure he's even going to arrive. And then there's David. Samuel comes and he anoints David king. Now he's a young man, about 17, 18 years of age. You remember being 17 or 18? Last night we had about 200 youth here to join us for our evening service last night. It was a great service. And at the end of it, the young man who organized the thing, Yosef, said a prayer for Pastor Bob. He said, you know, Pastor, Lord bless Pastor Bob, because at his age, his bones don't feel as good as they used to. And they creak and they ache, didn't he? He prayed on. So I'm like, every day as he's praying, I'm going, But I remember being 17, 18, a young man like that young, vibrant young man there. And I can't imagine receiving an anointing and a prophecy going to be king of Israel. I can only imagine the thoughts that went through David's head. But I'm sure that the thoughts that went through his head were not that he'd have to spend 7 to 10 years of his life running from the current king who was trying to kill him. Life does not always unfold. Are we there? Are we okay? Zzz, it's electrocuting me. Zzz. You there? Okay, we'll try it one more time. If not, I'll grab the handheld. I don't know what's wrong with this thing. We get it fixed and then it starts acting up again. I don't know. It's kind of like my old printing presses. Every printing press I ever printed on had a personality, and boy, did they have personality quirks. But you know, life doesn't always unfold as we think it should, even when we have a word from God. Consider Mary, the mother of Jesus. Now, we don't know how old she was, but theologians speculate that she was somewhere between 14 and 18 years of age. Now I want you to think about a young girl, 14, 18. Do you really think that she thought her life would unfold with an angelic visitation of an angel telling her that she was going to get pregnant, but no man was going to be involved? I don't know about you, but I probably wouldn't expect that one. In fact, if my wife came to me when we were engaged with that story, as much as I trust my wife, I really probably would have some suspicions. Life does not always unfold the way we think. How many of you thought on 9/11 15 years ago that when you got up on that morning that planes were going to crash into the trade towers and seek to crash into the Pentagon and the White House or the Capitol building? I didn't. I was in Virginia Beach with Pastor Bill and Pastor Rick and Pastor Carl, pastors on staff here, at a conference with Jack Hayford. And I'll never forget when Jack Hayford came out when the conference started, like 5 or 10 minutes in, and he said, we've got to close the conference because basically America's under attack. And who would have envisioned and who would have thought that the last 15 years would unfold the way that they did? I remember President Bush getting up before 9/11 and speaking about the economy and talking about how America had a surplus of money and how we were going to invest all this money into our future and how rich we were and how blessed we were. And I remember thinking to myself then, I don't know what year it was, but I remember saying, boy, there's a lot of presumption there. There's a lot of assumption there. And I remember that speech. And I remember when President Bush declared that the war in Iraq is won. And I remember when President Obama declared that Al-Qaeda is on the run. And who would have thought, who would have imagined that our lives and American culture and American history would unfold the way that it has in the last 15 years? We've experienced the greatest recession since the Great Depression. All that money we had saved and looked like we were prosperous, now we have the biggest deficits and liabilities in the history of the world. And when we look at the Middle East and all that we tried to do there and everything that we've tried to accomplish, has the plan unfolded the way that we wanted it to? Now we have an enemy called ISIS, the JV team. Hear me, church. America has problems. This is the weekend of 9/11. Our churches ought to be overrunning with people. But how soon have we forgotten? Complacency rules in our land. While our leaders make deals with the devil. And I turn on the TV and I've stopped watching the news. I just do it enough to find out. To me, the news is a soap opera anymore. It's the same old, it's just different faces and different names. And so I only turn it on enough now to kind of know what's going on because I feel it's my responsibility as a leader to know what's going on, but it doesn't seem to change a whole lot. And then as I watch it, everybody seems to have answers. Everybody seems to be telling everybody else what the solution to the problems are. And I have become convinced that we don't even know what the questions are. So how can we have the right answers? You know, many have dismissed the Bible as a source of guidance and wisdom today. Many have dismissed it as irrelevant and an old-fashioned book that ought to be left on the shelf and left to itself. But I'm here to tell you that if we are going to get out of the mess we are in, we've got to open this book up again and begin to listen to what it says, because what it says is just as relevant today as it was when it was first recorded. And I'm going to prove that to you today. Every one of us have many questions, and I don't have time to go over all of them, but we have at least 9 questions that you and I ask all the time. And those 9 questions began not with our lives, but they began in the Garden of Eden when Adam and Eve were put in the garden and God told them, you can have every fruit of the trees that you want, but there's one tree that you can't eat of, the tree of knowledge and good and evil, because the day that you eat of that tree, you are going to die. Now, what is dying? If you remember last week, I said blessing is increase. And for those that you weren't here, you need to watch the video online. That's one of the messages that I think everybody in our church needs to see and hear. Because it's what I believe God is saying to us. Not every message I preach do I think everybody needs to go back and archive it. But I'm here to tell you, if you weren't here, you need to listen to that video. Or listen to it when you're driving somewhere. Download it. Whatever you do with these computers these days. I have no idea. I have people that do that for me. Because when it comes to computers, I'm an idiot. No, I'm not, Patrick says. Thank you, Patrick. Patrick, you're the only one that knew that I was trying to solicit praise. He's the only one that's listening. You know, you call yourself an idiot, so people say, no, you're not. You're really good at that. You know, that's what, you know. Back in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve ate the fruit and disobeyed God, they opened a door. See, everything was meant to increase, and they were meant to subjugate the earth and have dominion. And then when they ate of that tree, now the curse entered. Now, what is the curse? The curse is decrease. What is dying? It's when you decrease. The complex body biologically begins to break down. You become less and less and less till you become dust, to return to what you were taken from. That entered the world when Adam and Eve rebelled against God and did what he said not to do. Now, what I want you to see today is that, first of all, their actions were actually, when they sinned and what they did after they had done what God told them not to do, their actions reveal questions that we ask every day. The first thing that happened after they committed that sin is the Bible says they took fig leaves and sewed them for clothes and covered their nakedness. Now, why did they do that? And what question were they really answering? You see, when they ate of that fruit, their eyes were open, and then they experienced something they had never experienced before. It's called guilt. Now, everybody in this building knows what guilt is. Guilt is that feeling that you've done something wrong. You've violated a command. You've done something bad. And so what they did to answer the question, and you and I ask this question every day or regularly, unless we have a seared conscience, we ask, what do I do with my guilt? I don't know about you. I say dumb things. I do dumb things. I hurt people. I say things I ought not to. I do things I ought not to, and I don't want to. Can anybody relate to that? What do you do when you're an idiot? It's a question I ask all the time because I have idiocracy as a gift. It's my spiritual gift. And you feel like a heel and you feel bad. You hurt somebody's feelings. My gosh, I hate when I preach and say something and somebody's feelings get hurt. I really hate it. I don't want to hurt people. I'm trying to live my whole life to love God and love people. When I do stupid things or say stupid things, it really bothers me. So I ask the question, what do I do with my guilt? Then it says that they hid themselves among the trees. Why did they hide? They were hiding because they were ashamed. They didn't want to look God in the eye. They didn't want to look him in the eye and say, we did what you didn't want us to do. And shame is not just a feeling of guilt. Shame goes deeper. Shame says, not only did I do something wrong, shame says there's something wrong with me. Shame says I'm broken. Shame says that because I'm broken, I need to hide my brokenness. Because if people or God ever find out who I really am, they'll hate me. They'll reject me. Folks, I'm here to tell you guilt and shame are rife through our culture and rife in this church building today. We deal with shame. We're afraid if people really knew what I thought and how I was motivated and how I live or whatever it is, we'd be left alone. So Adam and Eve hid. Then they ran from God because they were afraid of him. They experienced fear for the first time. Fear of God. It says they were afraid because they heard the presence of God. They were actually afraid of God. They were afraid of being in his presence. So they hid from him. And fear became a dominant emotion in humanity. And we still ask the question, what do we do with our fear? Last night as we were ministering to folks, I was just moved by the number of people that were saying, Pastor Bob, I need prayer for anxiety, which is a form of fear. Then they blamed each other. God says, well, who told you were naked in the first place? Immediately, Adam throws his wife under the bus. And not only does he throw her under the bus, he puts it in reverse and backs up over. Doot, 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 doot. It's the woman you gave me. If you just give me a better wife, Lord, I wouldn't have done that. That's what he's saying. And ultimately, guess who he's blaming? He's blaming God. God, if you didn't give me this woman, I wouldn't have done this. God gets blamed for a lot. Oh, Eve, she didn't stop. Ladies, you're not off the hook. She says, the serpent deceived me. It's that serpent you created, God. And we've been passing the buck ever since. They played a spiritual pin the tail on the donkey, and each other was the donkey. Those are four questions we ask. What do we do with our guilt? What do we do with our shame? What do we do with our fear? What do we do with our anger? I'm leading you somewhere, so just hold on. Five other questions got birth when Adam and Eve rebelled, unlike Jeopardy. See, in Jeopardy, you get the answer and you have to figure out the question. And I would say to you, I would submit this morning to you that in America, we're playing a game of Jeopardy. We seem to think we got all the answers, but I'm not sure we know what the questions are. And so I'm here to ask for the question, Alex, for 1,000. Because there's a question I think that we all ought to ask ourselves before we leave this building today. Because it's the fundamental question that's going to change the course of America. When they sinned, I shared last week that they got a new enemy, the devil. They got pain and suffering. They got resistance to the work that they were doing. The ground was cursed, which meant decrease. And so some of the questions, five of the questions that were birthed right in that situation is, number one, is why is life so difficult? Have you ever woken up on a bad day or even a good day and say, why is life so hard? I don't know about you, but I get tired of being hard. Do you? Life can be hard. It seems like I get going good, things get going good, and then something kicks me in the teeth. What about you? I don't know about you, but I've been kicked in the teeth this week. I can't talk about it, but I've been kicked in the teeth. And there are days I just say, why is life so hard? There have been times I prayed, God, why is it so hard? He answered it right in the book. The world screwed up. And so are you, Bob. Why is there such relational conflict? Why can't husbands and wives get along? Why can't church people get along? Why can't people and nations get along? Why is there so much conflict between people? If everybody's been made in the image of God, don't you think we ought to treat one another a little better? Don't you think that there's a better answer than blowing each other up and shooting each other with machine guns or gossiping about each other or leaving a church because you got your panties in a wad? Come on, church, I'm telling you, why are these things a reality? Because the world is screwed up by a thing called sin. And it started in the garden. And we can elect all the politicians we want, and we can raise all the money we want, and we can fight all the causes we want. But I'm here to tell you, until Jesus Christ reigns in the hearts and minds of people, these things are going to be a problem on the earth. Because the problem's in us. Gender wars started way back in the garden. Who's going to wear the pants in the family? But it don't end there. I just feel in a culture that everybody wants to wear the pants. Amen. I prayed years ago. I wish I hadn't prayed this. I'm regretting praying this because God's answering my prayer. I said, Lord, make me a better listener. You ask my wife, everywhere I go now, when people hone in on me, they go, let me just talk at you. Let me say something. No, just listen. And God's answering my prayer. He's teaching me to be a listener. The problem is what I'm hearing is a lot of answers. But I have to be honest, I'm not sure Americans know what the questions are. Why is it so hard to make ends meet? Have you ever struggled paying your bills? Have you ever struggled? Look, I said last week, I'm a saver. I was a saver as a kid. I remember making $25 when I was like 10 years old. I put 24 of it in the bank. I spent $1 on candy. You can get Reese's Cups for 5 cents. Remember that? So I got like 20 of them, ate myself sick, and put the rest in the bank. Well, why is it so hard to save? Why is it so hard to get ahead? Right back there in the garden, he said, the ground's going to resist you. Why don't I have anything to wear, ladies? You got a whole closet full of clothes. Now, I'm really getting the ladies really going, but guys, I'm going to get to you in a minute. Young men, let me just warn you. It's not how many clothes they have. It's the moment. Selah. And I just alienate every woman in the building. Trying to loosen up a little bit. I'll pay for that one. God had to make skins from animals. He had to kill an animal to cover the nakedness of man. Because the clothes weren't getting it covered. And I said last night, and I weighed it out really in dangerous territory last night. I said, many of our clothes still ain't getting it covered. I'll leave it there. I went into a long dissertation about that last night. But I think I'll skip it this morning. My wife's going, amen, amen, brother, amen. I think she had a tape under the, cassette player with backward masking all night. Don't talk about modesty. Don't talk about modesty. Because I got into it last night. Why do we die? Why do we age? You know, we age. I don't know if you realize this or not yet, but you're aging. You know what aging is? Aging is, see, when you're young, your body is under the blessing. You're increasing. Then you plateau. It's called maturity. Then when you get mature, you don't stay long. It's like a flower. You ever get roses for your wife? You need to get roses for your wife or your girlfriend or your mother or your somebody or your dad. Get them for your dad. I like roses too. You watch a rose. You buy roses. They last for about a week. You spend $100 on roses and they're gone in 8 days. They look beautiful when they mature and they open up, but the next thing you know, they're beginning to decay and fall apart. You know, that's how we are. When you reach maturity, you begin to die. Now, what is dying? Your body literally, biologically, is not putting you back together at the same level you were before. We're decreasing. That's what death is. We were never intended to die. Take a picture of my favorite actor, man's man. Everybody know who he is when you see him. Who's that? A young John Wayne. Look how young he looks. Man, he's young there. He's probably not gotten that walk yet. You know that walk he had? He never moved his hips. Here's a picture of him when he was older. A few changes there, don't you think? Why does that happen? Started right back in the garden. You see, I can tell you that every one of us are still asking all 9 of those questions in our lives today at some point. And here's the challenge. We're still coming up with answers to those questions in one way or another. For instance, when we feel guilt, often we'll do image management. We'll do like Nixon. We'll cut the 18-minute gap in the tape and try to hide the thing. Try to cover it over so people don't know the truth. When we feel guilty, we don't want to look guilty. So we sometimes do image management. Or when we feel ashamed and we're afraid that people, if they really knew who we are, we begin to play. We begin to be pretentious. We begin to pretend. We begin to put on shows. We try to keep up with the Joneses. We like to drive new sports cars. You know, when we're getting older, all of a sudden, when a man gets older, I don't know, when I hit about 45 years of age, all of a sudden, I wanted a truck. I want to go out and buy gold. Went to the hairdresser. Got a perm. No, I didn't do the perm thing. I don't have enough hair for that. You want a sports car. You want something to cover you up that you're dying. That life's changing. That you're in a season and we don't want to admit that we're broken and flawed. And so we do all this pretentious stuff. Or when we're afraid, we'll run away. I'm amazed at how often people run away. They just run away from relationships. They run away from conflict. We have a victimness mindset in our culture where as soon as we're attacked, we just kind of fold. I can't do anything. And one of the things that I want to do is I want to get people to rise up and say, I'm not going to take it anymore. I'm going to move forward. I'm going to fight, not just flight. But we do that. We just... sometimes, and when we get angry, we tend to scapegoat. I'm watching the political scene, and everybody's blaming everybody else. When's the last time somebody got up and said, I'm screwed up, and I messed you up, and I'm going to fix it? Instead, everybody tries to deflect guilt. That's what blame is. Let's deflect guilt. Don't take responsibility. And when politicians, many of them, there are some good ones. I've got some friends. I know, Kevin, when you get elected, you're going to be a good one. I know my friend Gary. He's a great man. There's others that are great politicians, but I'm talking about generally speaking here. We've got a culture that won't take responsibility, and we blame our politicians, but we do the same thing. And we've got to learn is, why do we do this? Because we're fallen and broken, and we scapegoat. Everybody else is the problem. Donald Trump wants to castigate Hillary Clinton, and Hillary Clinton wants to castigate Donald Trump. I'd love to see an election where a president stand up and say, let me tell you all my faults. Then decide. I'm doing a better job preaching than your amen. And we can't understand that life is difficult. We don't understand that we often get bitter and angry, and I meet a lot of angry people. My gosh, you know, Americans, we ought not be angry and bitter. We live better than 95% of the world. You know, and this statistic is kind of, I haven't read it in a while, so it might be a little bit inaccurate, but it's close. Do you know that we have 90 to 95% of the world's wealth? And it's never enough. When we have conflict, we either attack or withdraw. When we dress, we either engage in materialism or immodesty. And when we're confronted by death, we often live in denial. I don't know how many funerals now, more than I care to admit. And one thing I'm always amazed at with funerals is how shocked people are. Yeah, they were 107 years old and they died. I'm just surprised, Pastor Bob. Brother liked that. He said, I've been there at those funerals. Death's going to happen, folks. It's going to happen. Maybe it's because I'm midlife. Maybe because I'm 53. I wake up someday and say, I'm going to die. What are you going to do with the rest of your time here? How are you going to make a difference? What is worth investing in? See, I'm asking questions. Let me suggest to you the answer to all nine of these questions. The answer to all nine of these questions: what will I do with my guilt? What will I do with my shame? What will I do with my fear? What will I do with my anger? What will I do with my denial? What will I do with conflict? What will I do with modesty and materialism? What will I do with death? That all of these questions will never be adequately resolved until we find the answer in Jesus Christ. Jesus is the only answer for all nine of these. He'll take care of our guilt. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That tells me my guilt can be forgiven. I'm working on a message now. I can't wait to preach it. God's given it to me in pieces. But I'm here to tell you, recently the Lord has showed me that one of the problems in the church world is that we are way too sin conscious. We come and we receive Jesus Christ and we get forgiven and we go out of these doors and we live a life of guilt and shame. And all that the enemy knows that you're forgiven, but he keeps pounding your head with all your failures, all your mistakes. I'm talking about myself. And yet we've been forgiven, and what that does is it distorts how we live our lives. The Bible tells us that Christ has washed us. All we have to do is ask him, repent of our sins and ask him. Christ has dealt with our shame. Shame includes with it the fear of exposure. When we know we're broken, when we know there's areas of our life that are not pleasing to God or pleasing to other people, or we're doing bad and we continually do bad, we become ashamed and we live in a fear of exposure. And yet Jesus Christ has broken the power of shame by allowing mankind to crucify him naked on a cross. He literally exposed sin and the forces of evil for what they are. And I was reading this morning, in fact, I want to read it this morning because I didn't make this real clear last night. You see, let me tell you how the power of shame is broken. The power of shame is broken through exposure. We run from exposure. We run from letting God know. You see, in the Garden of Eden, instead of running to God and say, God, we messed up. We have our hands in the cookie jar. Instead, they ran from God, hid where they were from God. They hid the fact that they liked evil and they did it. You know, sometimes, folks, I just go to God and say, God, I like that evil. I'd really like to do it. Would you help me? I know I'm wrong, but I really want to do wrong. I like wrong. People say, oh my gosh, I thought the pastor's supposed to be holy. I am, but I'm human. And I'm here to tell you, there's some things that you want that ain't good for you. And the quicker you and I get clean with that and expose it, it removes the power. Watch what happens. It says in Colossians 2, speaking of the cross, it says, having disarmed principalities. That means he's taken the guns out of the hands of the devil and his minions and powers. He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. In other words, the power of sin, the power of evil has been broken because Jesus exposed it on the cross for what it is. So that you and I don't have to live in shame. Now, I'm not saying if you're here this morning and you got great guilt or things in your life that you go telling everybody, but I can tell you this. You can find a pastor like me, or you can find a good friend that has sealed lips that's confidential, and you can get that thing off your chest and you can begin to get whole again. Because shame will ruin your life. It's amazing how sin loses its power when it gets exposed. Jesus is the answer to fear. 1 John 4:17-19 say that love is perfected in this, that we'll have boldness in the day of judgment. That there is no fear in love. Now he's talking about fear of judgment. We don't have to be afraid of God. When you sin, run to God. Man, I hurt for my kids. When they're hurting, I just want them to run to me. And I'm hurting now. Jesus is the answer. Jesus is the answer to denial. We got a world of denial. I didn't do that. I'm not responsible. I want evil, and that's good. When Jesus said, if you're my disciples, then you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Then there's relational conflict. Jesus is the answer to that, because according to 2 Corinthians 5, he's given to us the ministry of reconciliation. You see, we ought not to be conflict makers, folks. We ought to be conflict healers. Jesus is the answer to immodesty and materialism. Titus 1:5-1:15, it says, to the pure, all things are pure. Folks, be careful how you judge how other people dress and live. Because I've met people that may not be doing it all right, but their hearts are as pure as gold. And I've met people that look like they got everything together and their lives are literally in shambles. Because to the pure, all things are pure. And I do think we need some wisdom in the church when it comes to materialism and how we dress, because I'm just going to be honest with you, young ladies, men struggle with their eyes. And Jesus is the answer to the question of death. Now, I'm not finished yet. You need to hold on for a second. 1 Thessalonians 4, Paul writes to the church, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as those who have no new hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, we also believe that he'll bring those that have died in Christ with him. Then he talks about the resurrection and the rapture. And I tell you, the older I get, the more I believe these words. Because death is a reality. Now, I brought all this up to bring to a conclusion the things I'm trying to share with you. See, in November, excuse me just a minute. In November, we will be voting for a new president. And there's a lot of people think that Donald Trump is the answer. And a lot of people think Hillary Clinton is the answer. I'm here to tell you, if that's what you believe, you don't know the question. Now, I'm not saying you shouldn't vote, and you should vote. And I'm not saying who you should vote for, though I have a strong opinion. If you want to hear it, I'll let you know at the end of the service. And I can give you reasons why. All I would say to you on who you choose to vote for is you got to vote for somebody. Some people are like, I don't have to. Yes, you do. You're a citizen. Amen. And if you don't vote, I don't want to hear any griping or complaining about what happens. None. People gripe to me all the time. I'm tired of hearing it. I'm not a garbage can. Do something about it. Amen. But measure your candidates. And if you have to choose between the lesser evils, then choose the lesser evil. We don't have a Nero yet. And Paul called Nero and the Roman government the servants of God. We got to get an adjusted mindset on some of these things. But in November, we're going to elect the president. And I'm praying that God would put the right person in office. But I'm really praying that America would figure out the real question. And here's the question that I want you to leave with. Why is America in decline? I don't think I have to make the case for us being in decline. You hear it on the news every day. Pundits now openly say America's in decline. We're not even debating that anymore. America's in decline. We've gone from surpluses in money to trillions of dollars. They're saying there's over $100 trillion in liabilities, and I hear nobody talking about when those notes come due, how are they going to be paid? I don't hear anybody talking about that. It's like it doesn't exist. I got news for you. The day of reckoning, when you want the paycheck that the government owns you, what are they going to do? I call that decline. When my debt rises above my income and my savings, I call that decline in my life. My house was paid off at 30 years of age. I live different. I have a mortgage on my house, but if I wanted to, I could pay it off right now. The only reason I'm not paying it off is I save taxes. I'm going to do a money series in November. You'll want to listen to me. I got some good sense to tell you about money because I've been doing it the way the book says. Forget all the economists. Listen to the book. It will bless you. You want to get out of debt? You want to be the head and not the tail? I'm telling you, follow this book. It works. And if our leaders would just turn to the book and say, how do we get out of this mess? We can get out of this mess. You know how much $100 trillion is? You could stack $100 bills here to the moon and back. It's a lot of money. It's about half of what I got. Why is America in decline? Why do we have less? Why are our enemies flying into buildings? I don't believe God's judging at us all. I believe we're reaping the consequences of our decision making. Amen. You do certain things. The Bible says, in fact, I wrote it down because I can't always quote. I'm getting to an age now where I can't quote like I used to. I mess some words up and that kind of thing, and I'm always afraid of misquoting the Bible. So Proverbs 26:2 says, like a flittering sparrow, like a flying swallow, so a curse without cause will not alight or rest. Curses decline. What the Proverbs writer Solomon is saying is that decline has a reason. Same way in our lives. Look, you can love the Lord and handle your finances terrible. I've met many good people, wonderful people, don't know, have a clue on how to handle finances. And then you can be blessed of God in your relationship with Him, but your finances can be messed up because there's principles that God has established in His Word and in the world that work. It's not all about giving. Man, there's a lot more in the Bible than giving. Giving's one principle, but there's more than that. But why? Why is America in decline? And I was reading and preparing this message, and I stumbled upon a poem that I think summarizes where we are. And it goes like this. Now I sit me down in school where praying is against the rule. For this great nation under God finds mention of Him very odd. If Scripture now the class recites, it violates the Bill of Rights. And any time my head I bow becomes a federal matter now. Our hair can be purple, orange, or green. That's no offense, it's a freedom scene. The law is specific, the law is precise. Prayers spoken aloud are a serious vice. For praying in a public hall might offend with one with no faith at all. In silence alone we must meditate. God's name is prohibited by the state. We're allowed to cuss and dress like freaks and pierce our noses, tongues, and cheeks. To quote the good book makes me liable. We can elect a pregnant senior queen and the unwon daddy our senior king. But it's inappropriate to teach right from wrong. We're taught that such judgments do not belong. We can get our condoms and birth controls, study witchcraft, vampires, and totem poles. But the Ten Commandments are not allowed. No word of God must reach this crowd. It's scary here, I must confess, when chaos reigns, the school's a mess. The question is, why is America in decline? And the answer is this. The reason, I should say, is this. We have forsaken the living God. And so you know what the answer is? If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Folks, I'm begging you not to blame politicians and leaders. Man, I just was with two of them yesterday. Wonderful people at an event, trying hard locally to bless our people, trying to meet needs. And man, it is an uphill climb for them. Pray for them. Because they need God's help. It's time for us to take responsibility for our nation and for our communities. It's time for us to begin to seek the face of God. We've got a short video by Franklin Graham, and then Matt is going to wrap this up for us.
If we want God to heal our land, it starts with you. It starts with your personal decisions. It flows from personal decisions to us corporately. And once God gets a hold of this people, then he gets a hold of the community. He begins to change things like our schools, like our government, and eventually our world. So you received a little bus on your way in today. Gives you all the information that you need to know about this Franklin Graham event, because if we are going to do this, we got to show up. What are you going to do as a result of the word that you have heard today? If you need a ride, please go out to Connections Corner and sign up that you need a ride to this event. If you can offer a ride, sign up that you can offer a ride to this event, because this is one of those things that that we need your help with. Now, we know that it's really difficult to follow Jesus in this day and age, and so with that, we're getting ready to start a new series next week called The Game of Life. We're really excited about this series. It's going to be practical teaching about the decisions that we have to make as we go through this thing that we call life. Really excited to hear what Pastor Bob is doing with that. And because we're really excited, we want to give you an opportunity to invite the community, to invite your neighbors, to invite your friends. So we're doing some things differently to give you some resource to be able to do it, to help you carry the gospel and show them. So one of them is this. It's in my pocket. It's that easy. So we have all of these cards. They're just Game of Life promos, little business cards that you can take. They have all the service times, all that stuff. The ushers will be at the doors to give these to you. Take some. Make sure that you put them in the hands of people. Don't just go, here, I have this for you. Tell them what's going on. Tell them what it's about. You'll also see a couple of videos show up on Facebook and on Instagram this week. So if you're given a card, awesome. That is personal, hand to hand. But if you are on social media, let's use it for everything that it's got. So if you are not a friend of Eagle's Nest on Facebook, go and like Eagle's Nest on Facebook. Go to Eagle's Nest CH on Instagram, like that. You'll see these videos come out that you can share. Mark did an awesome job with them. They're really, really good. So be sure that you take those, push those out. This is something that we're doing so that you can continue to share the gospel, to reach the community, and this series could be something that revolutionizes people's daily lives with practical truth from the book. So please, please, please don't wait, don't hesitate. Make sure that you grab these, share it, invite folks. It starts here, right here with you. It goes through us and it reaches out into the community. Amen? Amen. Amen. Take it away, fellas.